Ya limadet and welcome everyone. My name is Dr. Faisal Kermali and I will be moderating today's Fields of the Future speaker series exploring aerospace engineering. A little bit about me. I'm an assistant professor at Harvard Medical School and honorary secretary of Aga Khan Education Board. The Fields of the Future series is hosted by Aga Khan Education Board with the aim of exploring career paths, innovation, and opportunities in selected fields of the future. As for today's edition, we will begin by reflecting on knowledge society and the purpose of education in Islam. At this time, I would like to invite Riaz Dinani, our Fields of the Future team member, to share this reflection.
Thank you, Ansek. Hello, and Yalamuth, everyone. Welcome to our final episode of Fields of the Future Speaker Series, Part 2. My name is Riaz Dinani, and I am a Fields of the Future team member serving on the Aga Khan Education Board for the United States. Before we begin, I would like to share this quote by the Aga Khan, given at the inaugural ceremony of the delegation of the Ismaili Imamate in Ottawa on December 6, 2008, and I quote, "In Islamic thought, as in this building, beauty and mystery are not separated from intellect. In fact, the reverse is true. As we use our intellect to gain new knowledge about creation, we come to see even more profoundly the depth and breadth of its mysteries. We explore unknown regions beneath the seas and in outer space. We reach back over hundreds of millions of years in time. Extraordinary fossilized geological specimens seize our imagination. Palm leaves, amethyst flowers, hedgehog quartz, sea lilies, chrysanthemum, and a rich panoply of shells. Indeed, these wonders are found beneath the very soil in which we tread, in every corner of the world, and they connect us with far distant epochs and environments. And the more we discover, the more we know, the more we penetrate just below the surface of our normal lives, the more our imagination staggers. Just think, for example, what might lie below the surfaces of celestial bodies, all across the far-flung reaches of our universe. What we feel, even as we learn, is an ever-renewed sense of wonder, indeed, a powerful sense of awe and of divine inspiration." The discovery of knowledge is fundamentally intertwined with the ethics of our faith, and I hope that our conversation today will highlight the opportunity to discover knowledge in the field of aerospace. Now, before I hand it off to Ansek Faisal to introduce our speaker this afternoon, I would like to thank the team and partners for all their hard work in organizing these events. And if you would like to join the team in the future, please email team@fieldsofthefuture.com to get involved in the development of the next series. Thank you, and Yali Madath. Back to you, Ansek.
Thank you, Riaz. Let's meet our speaker for today. Dr. Farah Ali Bey has been a systems engineer at NASA's Jet Propulsion Lab, otherwise known as JPL, for the past 7 years. She is currently a systems engineer on the Perseverance rover, which landed on Mars on February 18, 2021. She has held a number of tasks on this mission, including testing its mobility system, supporting preparations for surface operations, and now leading tactical shifts during surface operations, as well as being the operations interface with the Mars Helicopter Technology Demonstration Ingenuity. Ingenuity performed the first powered flight on another planet in April 2021. Prior to joining the M2020 team, she worked on the InSight Mars lander, as well as its companion mission, the Mars Cube-1 CubeSat. Dr. Ali Bey possesses an undergraduate and master's degree from the University of Cambridge in the UK and a PhD from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, all in aerospace engineering. Before we begin, I would like to encourage our audience to ask questions throughout the session. You can do that by using the Q&A feature of Zoom and entering your questions there. The upvote feature is enabled, so if you have the same question as someone else, please like it and it will rise to the top of the Q&A box. Our team will be noting the questions to be asked during the Q&A session towards the end. The recording of this session, along with the presentation, will be shared on our website. fieldsofthefuture.com. And now, without further ado, Farah will speak to us about her career path, new opportunities within her field, and how this field of the future will evolve.
Thank you for having me. So did you want me to start a little bit on sort of my career path and where I am and how I got here today?
Yeah. And a bit before you start, thank you so much for joining us today. It's great to have you here. If you could tell us a bit about what you do and your career path to begin with, that would be great.
Yeah. Okay. So I have kind of a little bit of a strange life background in that I've immigrated a lot and moved around a lot, but sort of give you the 2 minutes life story of Farah. So I was born in Quebec, actually. I was born in Montreal, so I'm French speaking. And my parents immigrated there from Madagascar, as did a lot of other Malagasy people in the 70s. And so I grew up speaking French, and I grew up having kind of a love of space. I mean, I grew up in the 90s, and so I grew up with Star Wars and Star Trek and Apollo 13 and all those movies, and always really, really liked space, but never really realized that that could be a career path. When I was a teenager, we ended up moving to England for my father's job, and that's how I learned English, actually. So you can probably hear in my accent like a weird mix of French and British. That's where it's from. And so from there, as I was going through high school or the equivalent of high school, I realized that I had an affinity towards math and physics. And it took me a little while, but eventually I put two and two together and figured that, like, oh yeah, I'm always taking things apart and breaking things, and I'm good at math and physics, and I love space. And there's actually a job that does that. And it's not just, you know, being an astronaut, which is also what I dreamt of. But, you know, there's a field called aerospace engineering, and that might be what I want to do. So from there, I went to the University of Cambridge to do a joint undergrad master's. And during that time, I did a number of internships. And that, for me, was really a good way to figure out where in the field of aerospace I wanted to fit. Aerospace engineers are quite multidisciplinary, right? So I worked, for example, one of my summers at an aerospace company, but another I worked at Bentley Motors on cars, and it's actually the same type of engineering, oddly enough. And so I worked on aerial vehicles, jet engines, all of that. But through that experience, I realized that I really loved space, and I really liked planetary exploration. So eventually I ended up at MIT to do my PhD. And from there, I did even more internships and found JPL, and really thought that JPL was the place that I wanted to be at. So to give you a background of JPL, it's based here in Los Angeles, California. I can't complain about the weather out here. and we solely do robotic exploration. So we do robotic exploration of our own planet, of the solar system, and of the universe through observatories and things like that. So we don't deal with human aerospace at all here. But it allows us to go to these far out places where we can't send humans yet. And one of the big things that we do is Mars exploration. Turns out it's the second closest planet to here and the easiest one to land on. So we like going there. And actually one summer, in the summer of 2012, when I was out here, was the summer that the Curiosity rover landed on Mars. And, you know, that's a good way to sell a place to work when you land an SUV size rover on another planet. So I fell in love with JPL, and that's how I ended up here. So I've been at JPL now 7.5 years, I guess. As was mentioned, I've worked on a variety of missions. Turns out I've worked on Mars a lot, even though I have a background in more broadly in planetary science and it's been a pleasure. I mean, it's been incredible to have been part of, you know, I've been part of the team that's landed two robots on Mars now. I worked on InSight and now Perseverance and of course flown on Mars. So it's been a ton of fun. And so hopefully through the discussion today, you can get a glimpse as to why I think this is so much fun. And we can talk a little bit more about some of the decisions that I made in my career path as well.
That's amazing. I mean, it sounds like a dream, and that everyone wants to keep playing as they grow up.
And you have the opportunity to do that. I get paid to have it fun. Have fun, which is can't complain.
That's amazing. And just the opportunities you've had and your connection to being able to land on another planet, that's just amazing. Could you tell us if there's something you particularly enjoy about your work?
Yeah, I mean, everything. I think one of the beauties of what I do, especially working for JPL, which is a little bit different from, say, commercial aerospace, is that everything that we do is new. It's a one-off. So we're not really in the business of doing things that have been done before. We try and, that's always innovative. Once we get to a point where something is more common and regular, that's when we pass it on to industry and private sector, because they do those kinds of things a lot better. They're a lot more equipped to manufacture things like that. But what it means is that there is no precedent for anything that we do. Everything that we do is new. I can't, we flew a helicopter on Mars. It's not like I can grab one of those textbooks and be like, in 1995, this is how this was done. No, there isn't. There's papers out there of people who do research here on Earth and who develop the technology that we can use. But when it comes to how do you operate a helicopter on the surface of Mars, I'm literally writing the paper right now because I just did it for the first time, right? And I think that's the beauty of, that's what I really enjoy, right? And I'm not gonna lie, some of my job can be kind of routine. There's some days where I sit here and make PowerPoint presentations like everyone else. But it's the type of thing where, like, when it gets monotonous, I'm like, oh yeah, but no one's had to make a PowerPoint presentation on this before, right? Like it's all new. And that can be daunting and challenging, but I think it is to me the most rewarding thing is that you're not spinning a wheel, you're innovating and pushing technology forward through the work that we do, and that's what drives me.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, you're a pioneer basically. We heard a beautiful quote at the start of the session about the wonders of nature. And I'm wondering how you feel when your work results in new discoveries about the universe and creation.
It's incredibly humbling to even dare to ask the questions that we do and to dare to even, to have the audacity to explore in this way, right? So to give you a little bit of background, the Mars 2020 mission, the Perseverance rover, its goal is to evaluate whether there might have been life on Mars. And so, way background of like, I know nothing about Mars. Why would you think there was life there? It's a horrible planet. Well, about 2 billion years ago, Mars used to look like Earth. We know this from past exploration. There used to be liquid water, used to be a global magnetic field, a much thicker atmosphere than there is now. So we think that, Mars kind of looked like a smaller version of Earth. And part of, the work that we do, like the InSight mission, has been figuring out, well, what happened to Mars and why does it look like it this way? But what Perseverance is doing is saying, well, if 2 billion years ago, Mars used to look like Earth, then maybe there used to be life on Mars. Because if you look at Earth about 2 billion years ago, you were starting to get the evidence of sort of microbial life, right? So you had some very simple organisms, not even organisms, right? Sets of cells that were growing here on Earth. And so if you use Earth as an analog for Mars, we think, well, okay, could there have been life on Mars? So we're literally asking the question, are we alone in the universe? And, it's kind of a crazy question to ask, right? It's a question that existentially humans have asked themselves since the dawn of time, since we've realized who we are and internalize what humanity is, then the next obvious question is, well, is there anyone else out there, right? And to be part of a team that can seriously ask that question and start to answer these types of fundamental questions is something that is very humbling. We don't take it lightly. It's a very complex set of experiments, of course, but part of why I love working at NASA specifically is because the work that we do is not for profit. It's 100% shared with humanity, right? Like we share all of our data automatically. I mean, if you go to mars.nasa.gov and and look on them right now, you'll see all of our daily images are pushed every day. And they are for you. We are here to serve society and to improve our understanding of who we are as a humanity. And again, to be paid to get to do those things and to get to participate in this is something that is, it's exciting and humbling.
That's amazing. So speaking of being able to do this, you described your pathway and one pathway to enter this field. Can you describe other pathways that, what the tactical steps would be for students who are thinking about those, especially, we have a variety of students with different interests and skill sets.
Yeah, I mean, in general, let me speak generally and then specifically. So in general, when you're a teenager trying to look for your path, my advice is always to find what you're curious about and what you're excited about and use that as your path forward in life. I can tell you for me, when I was 15, 16, and I was good at school and I was good at sciences and pretty much like everything kind of came easy. Well, I sort of knew I wasn't going to be like an elite athlete or a best-selling author, right? Like there are things that we weeded out, but I had a lot of options and people will have expectations or biases towards what they think is a good job. And that's just because that's their life experience, right? And so I remember myself, I was often encouraged to be a doctor or a dentist or something like that because it was seen as a job that was, and there's great jobs, right? That you can provide well for your family, help society, things like that. But what I quickly discovered is that while those jobs were noble and I'm sure I would have been very happy in them, they weren't the fire inside, right? And they weren't what I was really passionate about. And so eventually that's the voice I listened to. So if you don't know what your fire is, well, take a step back. What is it when you look for a book? What is it that you're interested in, or a movie, right? Like, what is it that you want to learn about, or a documentary? The odds are that whatever that is probably something that you can make a job out of. It might not be obvious, but it's out there. So that's my generic advice. And so if you're saying like, yeah, Farah, I hear you, but I love space. Like, how do I get here? How do I do what you do? Well, there is a breadth of ways to work in the aerospace field. And it's again, kind of dependent on what aspect it is that you like and what it is that interests you, right? So for example, when you work on a mission like Mars 2020, we have an entire science team. So we have people who are biologists, chemists. We have all sorts of people who, geologists. And so there's a pathway through there. If that's what's interesting to you, if that fundamental discovery in science, typically the people that do those kinds of jobs will go and to be a scientist in aerospace, you typically need a PhD because you'll need to be able to publish and really, you're the ones investigating, doing the investigation, building the instruments, and then getting those results. Although we do have master's students here on our teams too. On the engineering side, so obviously we take engineers, all sorts of engineers, right? Like you don't necessarily have to be an aerospace engineer. We have electrical, mechanical, all of it. And at all ranges of education. So between undergraduate, master's, PhD. Where you stop and which one you choose is really a personal decision based on what your interests are. I always wanted to do a PhD, well, once I'd started in that field, because to me, there's a beauty in terms of being able to contribute to the pool of knowledge that humanity has, and to get to spend a few years of my life just diving into that one little corner. Some people find that terrifying and do not want to do that, and that's okay. And that's completely okay. And then outside of these two kind of main paths to aerospace, there's business paths, obviously, not within NASA and with the private industry, right? That's something that it's an industry like any other. So we have people who come in with just business degrees or things like that. And that's really valuable too. We have techs who don't even go to college that have really vocational fields. That's a perfectly good path also. And then we have all sorts of support staff at JPL. In addition to all the support staff, we have in-house artists who help us communicate the work that we do, UI, you know, interface engineers and designers. So you can have a background in design or art or pretty much, I think you could name me any career and I could, any degree, and I could find a place for you in aerospace. So it's really about contextualizing what you're doing. I kind of picked the obvious kind of on the nose path, but there's certainly all sorts of ways to get involved in aerospace.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that's great to hear that basically people with any set of interests, any set of expertise and skills can get into this field.
Yeah, I think the only common thread that we have is that we're space nerds. Like, that's about it.
Yeah, exactly. So you have to have that passion.
I think it's one of those things where, you know, it's a lot of long hours, it's a demanding job often, so that the passion helps you get through that, right? It helps you see the broader context. So certainly when I look for people on my teams, I look for that passion first, because everything else you can be taught, but that passion, teamwork, communication, those things are the things that I look for.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, and speaking of those, you know, I think in every career, there's hard skills and soft skills that we rely on. Could you tell us about a couple of soft skills that have been really essential to you?
Yeah, so I just touched on it, so that's an excellent segue here. So one of the things that's incredible about aerospace, but I think it's true, you know, if you look at most tech industries, you know, or jobs or fields right now, one of the wonderful things about what we do is that the systems that we build are incredibly complex, right? Like if you look at Mars 2020, the Perseverance rover, there is not a single person on a 1,000+ people team that fully understand that system. Like it is just too complex for a single human to comprehend. And so as a team, we build something that is bigger than ourselves. And that, you know, that's what a society is about, right? And that is something that's really incredible and magical about working on these teams. But what it means is that you have to work as part of a team. And so often people ask this question, right? Like, what's the most important thing that you look for on a resume when you're looking for someone on your teams? And, you know, is it that 4.0 GPA and all the extracurricular activities? And usually my answer is no. What I look for is the conversation that I have with you and whether you have demonstrated that you are a good team worker, a good communicator, and a good leader. And by the way, being a good leader doesn't mean always taking the lead and being the loud one in the room. It means listening to others, being inclusive of others, and supportive of your teammates. And to me, those are the most important skills. And the ones that I've spent a lot of time developing, right? And for those of you who are in high school or in college or perhaps already, you know, on these sorts of paths, you'll notice often, and I remember hating this in high school, I was like, why are we doing this? That your teachers make you do group projects. And it's always horrible because you're like, I have four people on my team and none of them want to work. And I end up doing all the work, right? Unless you're the person that's doing the work. But you know, you always think like, oh, it's not even or whatever, right? But the reality is that the reason why your teacher's doing that is not because they think that you can't do the work on your own or that you can't learn on your own. It's because they're trying to teach you those skills. And you know, sometimes you'll notice your teachers might pick the teams for you rather than letting you work with your friends. It's not because they're mean. I discovered this later. It's because they want you to learn to work in a team. And sometimes you don't get to pick your team and you have to make do with whoever is on that team. They might have different background to you. They might you know, they might think differently to you, but that's actually good things for us. So spending the time early on to develop those teamwork skills is really important. And the other is communication. So one of the things that I learned throughout, especially in college, was how to present my ideas, how to talk through complex ideas and distill them down for someone, right? And that 100% comes with practice. I You should have seen my slides in freshman year when I was trying to make a presentation. It was like a block of text and I was nervous at the front of the class trying to present what I was trying to do. No one was understanding what I was explaining. But with practice and help, that's something that you can develop. And that's important pretty much in any field. You have to be able to explain what you're doing, pitch ideas. You have to be able to explain problems if you want other people to help you or to buy into an idea that you have. So those are the two things that I typically look for and that I work on myself. The rest, I always say the rest can be taught. The rest, you can pick up a textbook and learn. Those soft skills, they're the ones that take time to develop.
So you know what I find really fascinating about what you just said is the most important skills to you are teamwork and communication. And even though you're in a STEM career, you name non-STEM skills as the two most important skills. And I think that's an important lesson that to succeed in STEM careers, we need both STEM and non-STEM skills. We can't just focus on, you know, math and physics. We need, you know, that's why we have English, social studies, you know, thinking of learning about philosophers in college, all of that,
yeah,
develop those soft skills and those non-STEM skills, which are important whether we're in a STEM career or not.
Yeah, absolutely. Things like critical thinking, right? That's a broad skill that applies to everything. And yeah, you're absolutely right, right? It puts into context why you're encouraged to have such a breadth of knowledge as long as you can in your education. I mean, even for me, like through college, I also learned languages. Those are things that, you know, I studied Spanish up until my last few years of college. I speak French, obviously, and English, and all of those skills that you think, you know, not your typical engineering skills are ones that I've used to my advantage throughout my career.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Maybe we can take a question from the audience. What was one of the biggest challenges you faced on the Mars 2020 mission?
Oh, so many. the Perseverance rover is the most complex rover that we've landed on another planet. Like I mentioned, every time we kind of make it harder for ourselves. One of the most complex systems within that rover is the sample caching system. So what Perseverance is doing, as I mentioned, it's looking for signs of life and it's of ancient life, and it's bringing, you know, it brought a set of instruments with it, but it also brought the ability to take samples from the surface of Mars, seal them, leave them on the surface, and eventually we'll go get them. And that allows us, when you're trying to answer such big questions like, was there life on Mars? It's a difficult thing to do, and you're limited, of course, in the instruments you can bring. So bringing the instruments back allows us to use whatever instruments, you know, we can design even on Earth to answer those types of questions. So that system has to be able to pick up a sample, pass it through a set of instruments, put it in a tube, seal that tube so that we don't get contaminants or anything. So it has to be incredibly clean because you don't want to bring, for example, bacteria or anything from Earth and then bring it to Mars and then not know if you got it from Mars or if it came from Earth and leave that on the surface of Mars. So that the design of that system was just as complex as the rest and as the rest of the rover, and it was brand new. And so it went through a whole lot of iterations and a massive team to get it done. But I would say as a whole for the entire team, the biggest challenge we had was actually COVID. We for context, we launched to Mars in July of 2020. So in February of 2020, when we were just hearing of this disease, we had shipped our rover from here in Los Angeles, because it was fully built, out to Cape Canaveral in Florida. But we still had testing and assembly left to do. And we were supposed to, you know, fly out there, get our work done, enjoy the launch, and then come home. And as I mentioned, we do a lot of our work in teams. And then comes, you know, mid-March 2020, and you get this email saying, hey, by the way, you're staying home. Figure out how to do your job. We're still launching in July, by the way. Good luck. And And it's like, okay, so now I have to work with my team on WebEx and operate my rover remotely. So thankfully, you know, we operate our rover remotely from Earth to Mars. So we had some of the tooling and things there, but it was a huge adaptation in terms of humans, right? Of learning how to do all the work that we do in this virtual environment. Some of us, I still had to go to work sometimes. So then dealing with that added stress in addition to everything that we had to do. The mission name Perseverance got chosen around February of 2020. And when it was chosen, I can tell you, so if you don't know the background, the Perseverance and Ingenuity were chosen through an essay contest that students put forward names and a story behind them. And so Perseverance got picked. And I thought, I don't even know if I know how to spell Perseverance. Like, is it an E? Is it an A? How many syllables is that? Like, why is it so complicated? You know, that's not a very catchy name. And then COVID hit and the name is just the description of our team, right? Like it became who we are. So as a team, I think that is the biggest achievement is that we were able to adapt to this very rapidly. You know, we didn't get the luxury of really, you know, getting to stop or worry about what was going on. We kind of had to keep going and we made it to the launch pad on time, which was quite incredible. And then landed on Mars. We landed on Mars in February, just as the vaccines were coming online. And we got a call from the president of the United States saying that, you know, it was a light. I think a lot of people described it as a light in at the end of a very long year. So to have been able to contribute to that a little bit was a nice way to wrap up that difficult time for us.
That's great. I just wanted to ask you about some. You said you switched to working with the rover remotely. So does that mean from your home laptop, you actually control the rover?
So when we do a hybrid, so we have people on lab. So for example, when we were doing the last test in Florida, we had people who were physically in Florida doing the testing. But I could like look at what was coming back from my home laptop. Yeah. And then, you know, I was called in and I could ask questions or send instructions from here. Once we launched, actually the cruise team that got the rover from Earth to Mars did all of that from home. Yeah. On that laptop, wow. Like, you know, called into meetings and commanding from home. I think there were like maybe a couple people on that from time to time, but it was mostly all from home. Once we landed, I mostly do operations from work because I'm one of the leads. So I have to be, I have to be there to send the commands and all of that. Like the way we do operations for the rover is we work typically during the Martian night and we build like a program for the rover. And then we send that up to the rover in the morning and then the rover does its thing and get data and so on. But I do most of that from work. Which is kind of still remote from Mars, but we do have like our science team and our instrument teams all support us from wherever their home institution is remotely. So we're sort of in a hybrid system right now.
I mean, I find it funny because I know a lot of people who can't even get their Microsoft Outlook to work from home and you guys are running a Mars rover. where do you see the field moving in 10 to 20 years?
You know, I think one of the things that is incredibly exciting right now is sort of this renewal in an interest in aerospace. I think in general, there seems to be a renewal in an excitement for science as a whole. I think if you ask people what the highlights were of this year, you'll get a lot of scientific achievements, the vaccine, the landing, things like that. So to me, that first is very exciting. I think we're seeing the public being really excited about things that are being done. Communications and the internet helps with that a lot, right? Like we get to share what we're doing with you. And so there's increased public support for exploration, whether it be man or crewed or uncrewed, robotic of space in general. It's been incredible over the past 10 years or so to see these private companies get built and and they've become sort of our main launch providers, right? SpaceX being one, and we see Blue Origin and all of those other companies emerging. And all of that is really great because they are all companies that provide support. And if I can get a cheaper rocket, that makes my mission cheaper, right? And so so I think we're going to see this industry continue to thrive. We're obviously moving more and more towards automation. And so we'll continue to see more ambitious robotic missions. I mean, we have Firefly, which is another flying mission that's going to Titan. We have two missions going to Venus in the next 10 years. We'll have Mars sample return, which is going to go pick up those samples, bring them back to Earth. That will happen within the next 10 years or so. And then we have sort of the, that's just in our solar system, right? Then we have James Webb that's going to look possibly at the origins of the universe and the Big Bang, right? Because it's a massive telescope that can, when you're looking at light that's coming towards the Earth, you can technically look back in time, which is a weird mind-bending process, but like to spend 1 minute on it, basically, you know, if you have an event that happened really far away and there was light being emitted, that light is traveling at the speed of light towards you, right? And so when it gets to you, it's old. So for example, if you look at Mars in the sky right now Mars is so far away that the speed of light from Mars to Earth is about 20 minutes. So if you with your naked eye or a telescope look at Mars, you're actually looking at Mars 20 minutes ago. And so if you extrapolate that to something really, really far away, you can see things that are decades, millions of years old. And that's how, essentially, if you look far away enough or at a faint enough light, you can look at the Big Bang or the origin of the universe. So James Webb is going to hopefully do that. So I think we're going to see sort of this explosion of knowledge, at least when it comes to exploration. In parallel with that, what is really exciting is that we're seeing more and more crewed missions too, right? So hopefully in the next 10 to 20 years, we'll see a return of humans on the moon, possibly even to Mars. I think that might be on the edge of that 20 years. But we're seeing all of these private companies that are bringing private astronauts to space. And that's exciting because it's making space more accessible. And again, reducing costs of getting out there. So I'm really hoping that this wave that we're on, you know, that we continue riding it, people see the importance of having a presence in space, but also of doing this fundamental work and learning more about our origins, but also about the origins of the solar system.
That's so exciting. It's amazing. In terms of crewed versus uncrewed missions, do you think they're both growth areas? One will have more growth than the other?
I think, you know, they are both important, and we have seen both areas grow. You know, if you just solely look at the budget and the interest of people through the past 5 years or so. I'm obviously a little bit biased that, you know, I work on robotic missions, and to me, it's like, yeah, you can go to Venus, you can go to Titan, you can go to Saturn, you can go to Mars. Like, we can go now. Our budget, honestly, is a lot smaller than it is for crewed missions, just because we send robots, we don't have to feed them or keep them alive in any way or entertain them. But we make extraordinary discoveries. On the other hand, there is nothing like the human perspective, right? And so if you look, for example, the Apollo missions, it's really interesting. They, you know, brought back some rocks, and there's a famous story of this rock that one of the astronauts brought back. And the only reason why he saw it is they were driving in their buggy, and he was like, well, that rock looks weird. Let's go around and get it, right? Can't really quite do that with robots yet, right? That human interface when you're doing activities, when you're exploring, is essential. And on the other hand, also that human perspective is what humanizes the work that we do, right? For example, again, in the Apollo missions, there's a very famous picture of the Earth, right? And you get this like blue full view of the Earth. And that was the first time that we'd gotten that picture. And that picture was emotional, because it came with a story. It came with the story of the astronaut that took the picture saying like, wow, I can see the entire humanity in my eyes right now. And look at how fragile this planet is. And that created a whole environmentalist movement, right? Like, that's how we realized that, like, well, we better take care of this planet. So there's that human touch when it comes to crewed missions, that is important. I think it appeals to people more, and it provides us a different side of exploration. So I think the two are complementary, and they're both very important. I expect that we'll continue to see both grow in the next 10 to 20 years.
Great. Thank you. I happen to be invested in crewed exploration, so I'm glad you don't think my field is dying. there's a question from the audience. I aspire to become an astronomer. Which subjects do you recommend taking to pursue this field?
So astronomy typically is more on the physics side of things. So it's a subset of physics, right? So if that's something that you're interested in, then typically in college, you will go down you would major in something like physics and then decide within that, you know, what type of astronomy you want to do. But you know, you could be involved in that field as an engineer as well, because someone's going to build those telescopes and you know, or you might be interested in the optics side of it, and so that's a mix of engineering and physics again. But typically, if that's what you want to do, then physics would be sort of the entryway towards going down that career path. Mm-hmm.
Great. And someone else asked about cybersecurity engineers in this field and what.
Oh, yeah. I mean, again, you could name any career path and we have a place for you, right? Certainly cybersecurity is something that we take seriously, and there are definitely cybersecurity engineers at our work, because we have to keep our data safe, and that's an emerging field as a whole. So definitely there's a place for those types of engineers within aerospace as well.
Okay. And someone else asked about combining math and physics with visual arts and architecture, and how the intersection of physics and art can translate into work at NASA.
Yeah, I mean, so as I mentioned, we have a whole team of literally in-house artists they're artists, industrial designers, UI engineers, and things like that. We have them all because, you know, part of what we do, especially at NASA, is that, you know, we don't have shareholders. We don't have people that invest in us. The public are our shareholders, right? We report back to you, the taxpayers, on what we do, and that is our job. So it's really important for us to be able to communicate what we do, not only on paper, but visually, right? And that's where that team comes in. And it's important not only when we're communicating results, but also some of the missions that we do, for example, the InSight mission, are competed missions. And so what that means is that what the government does, what the US government does, is that they'll put out a call and say, hey, I have $500 million for a mission. Tell me what you want to do. And we will look at, you know, there's every 10 years, there's a decadal survey that comes out there's one for planetary science and one for Earth, there's one for heliophysics and, you know, studying the sun, there's one for astrophysics. And what the decadal survey is that it gives sort of the scientific priorities in that field for the United States. So they will compare all of those proposals that we put in with what the goals are of the scientific community and pick a mission or multiple missions. Recently, there were two Venus missions that were selected through that process. Anyway, all that to say that we do have to bid for work. And when you're trying to bid to sort of a broad audience, like, hey, I want to build a mission to go to Venus to explore the volcanoes on the surface of Venus, for example, right? Visually communicating what you're doing and storytelling becomes very important, right? So it's usually you write a document of what you want to do, but telling the story of what is it that I want to do, how do I do this, and why is it worth this money is really important. And so those types of teams, for example, need those graphics designers, those storytellers, right? They're beyond just graphic designers, they're people who own the story. Sometimes we even bring in people from Disney to help us with storytelling. It's that important. So it's definitely, there's an intersection between all of those things for every mission or every task that we do. Again, right, we talk about STEM, but it's so much broader than that when you're trying to achieve complex things like this.
Awesome. You mentioned the decadal surveys. Can you tell us a bit more about what those are and how students and young professionals could use those to pick out fields of the future or growth?
So decadal surveys are, I guess I don't know if we have them outside of aerospace. I'm guessing they probably exist in other fields. I'm only really familiar with the ones that are related to aerospace.
But I know the National Institutes of Health also do some documents.
Oh, okay, that's great. I didn't know that. So there we go. I learned something today. So I guess more broadly outside of aerospace is that every 10 years for a particular field, the top scientists in the country and engineers will come together and essentially establish what the current state of the art in that field is, and then literally lay out what the goals are for the nation in the next 10 years, hence why it's called a decadal survey. So if you're looking at, for example, I remember when I started my career, I was looking at the latest, the 2010 or so decadal survey for planetary science, which is what I'm interested in. And you could see things like, if you go back and look at it, it talks about Mars sample return being really important. It talks about the exploration of Europa being really important. Those are two missions that are ongoing right now, right? And I'm sure if you went to the astrophysics one, you'll see something that's related to the James Webb telescope, right? So it really is the blueprint for where that field will go more or less in the next 10 years. And then, so it can really give you an idea, I guess, yeah, if it applies more broadly of okay, I'm just starting my career, like, what does it look like, the type of skills that they might need, or what are the interests that they might need, right? In my case, it's what planet might I want to go learn about, right? And because that's where the money is going to be, that's where the projects are going to be. And then the really neat thing is that you can also get involved once you reach a certain point in your career, but even fairly young, into influencing the next decadal survey. And typically the decadal surveys will lay out the next 10 years and then lay out kind of like, okay, beyond that horizon, here's sort of what we're interested in. So that can give you an idea also of like, okay, well, by the time that decadal survey is done, maybe I'm just starting my PhD now. And so by the time the decadal survey is done, we'll be kind of starting the next one. So where do I want to be, right? Where do I want to angle my career? It definitely sort of gives you that that perspective. So I think that's more, perhaps if you're at the master's PhD level, that's when you would start looking at those.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. These are available for free and they're basically laying out a roadmap for the future. And
it's really neat that they have them in other fields. I guess, I don't know why I didn't know that, but that's really good to know.
Yeah. I'm curious, have you faced any challenges as a woman of color in a male-dominated field?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's, it's one of the things that's been one of my biggest personal challenges is, I grew up in a predominantly Caucasian neighborhood in Canada. So I grew up almost always being a minority in a room. And then when I moved to England, it was sort of the same at the school that I was at. And I remember even when I decided I wanted to be an aerospace engineer and I, told my career advisor and she was like, she didn't mean badly, but she said, well, that's a male dominated field. I don't know if you're going to succeed there. And that was, had I not had, I'm the type of person that's like, what are you saying? Like, I'll show you, like, of course I can do this, right? But not everyone is, right? And being told by an adult or someone that's influential that's going to be a challenge for you, that can make you reevaluate really the career path that you go down. And so then, even when I was at Cambridge, the amount of women in engineering is only about 20% typically. And I was often the only woman in the room. certainly the only women of color. And that can be a challenge. I think particularly at that age, when you're a teenager or a young adult, you just want to fit in, right? It's hard enough as it is that, like, you don't want to be the different one in the room with the weird accent who has the, you know, who sees the world differently. And that can be a huge challenge. It can be intimidating. For me, it was even beyond that because I was from a different socioeconomic background than most people that I was around. And I was catching up. A lot of them had gone to private school and I'd gone to public school and didn't have the same privileges as they'd had growing up. And all of those things can make you feel really isolated. They can, I know for me, sometimes it's hard to imagine, but it was hard for me to speak up, you know, because I didn't feel like I belonged there. My first semester in college, I failed my exams because, I mean, it happens. It's really hard when you start college and you come from high school and you're like, this is not the same. And I remember, you know, in addition to like, okay, this sucks. Like, I have to go figure out how to do this, this math and physics. It was a challenge because I also didn't know if I belonged. And so I felt like I couldn't, I was like, maybe I don't belong here. Maybe I just shouldn't be here. And that continued, you know, throughout my PhD. I eventually found allies who gave me a seat at the table. But even when I came to JPL, like, part of me muted myself because I wanted to fit in. Certainly I've been treated differently because I was a woman or a person of color. But eventually I discovered that what I perceived as a weakness could be a strength. And so, because if you take the converse of I'm the only person of color, I'm the only woman in the room, well, I'm the only person of color, I'm the only woman in the room, right? Which means that if I do a good job, people will remember me. People, you know, there isn't two people called Farah with red hair at JPL, and there's only one Farah. So, but, you know, people see me coming and they know who I am. And that has become a strength for me. But that was a journey. And that was something that, you know, I have a particular personality and a particular way of seeing the world, which helped me with that. But that's not necessarily true for everyone. So now a lot of my work at JPL, in addition to the work I do, has been in diversity and inclusion and including people of all background, of, you know, all sexual orientations, all everything, because it's so important to have diverse teams. We talked about teamwork, right? Well, a team that is diverse, that has different experience, those are the teams that thrive. I don't want five Farahs on my team that have the same ideas as me, that look at life the same way, that have the same experience. That's useless. They're going to have the same ideas as me. I don't want people to agree with me. I want people from those different backgrounds who are, you know, who have those different experiences. So I guess to kind of wrap up this monologue, right? Like, of course it was hard. And of course, I'm sure a lot of you go through that daily of being different, whatever it is that makes you different. And it is hard, and know that, like, yeah, it's horrible. But there are people out there who are looking out for you. Find those people, find that help. None of us make it here on our own. And then in addition to that, take that as a strength. You know, once you, you know, embolden yourself with that difference and say, no, this is my strength and this is who I am, that will help you too. It makes it a little bit easier, and know that eventually you'll find that place where you are comfortable with who you are and you are accepted. I still fight some of those stereotypes still, but it does become easier over time as you make your place.
That's hard to hear, and I'm sorry you had to go through that, but I'm glad that you had that grit and perseverance to push through.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to talk about it, that it's not going to be easy, right? I think, you know, sometimes we talk about like, oh, this happened to me or whatever, and it'll be fine, right? The world is changing. And it's true that the world is changing, you know, the fact that we are talking about diversity and inclusion, but it's far from being perfect. And you're always going to face prejudice. I think most people have in their lives, unfortunately, some of us more than others. And I think it's important to hear that other people have gone through that too, that you go through those challenges, and And there are people out there like me that you can reach out to that, like when you're going through something. So find those people in your teams, and they come in unexpected shapes and colors. but there are people out there who, you know, for example, I was on a team where I had a manager that just wouldn't listen to me, right? And happened to be the only woman on that team. There was a time I remember very vividly. I had done an experiment, I had done a test, and he faced my younger male, white male colleague to ask questions for the test that I had done. And I was like, what are you doing? Right? Like, and, but what was great is that, you know, those male colleagues, I was able to talk to them. Well, they noticed that something wasn't right. Or I was able to talk to them and say like, hey, like, you know, have you noticed these things? Like, could you help me? And then they, you know, they stepped up and used that privilege to help me, right? And to say like, no, let's talk to Farah, right? Like, she's the one that did the work. And and once you start setting, you know, that kind of culture in a team, then it becomes more and more inclusive as well.
Okay. When you say talk to people, can you be a bit more tactical about, you know, let's say you gave the example of a professional. What about, you know, 17-year-old Farah, whose advisor was saying not to go into engineering?
well, that person, I was just saying, well, I'll do it anyway. The younger you are, depending on your situation, it can be different, right? Like when you're talking to people of authority, that can be difficult because you don't really know how to approach that. So if I take 17-year-old Farah, who was like, oh, should I go into engineering because it's a male-dominated field, and how are they going to accept someone with all my colors like me, right? Well, I remember that what I did is I went to talks and I met a professor at the University of Cambridge at one of those talks who was a woman. Actually, she has she does like signals work, but she had a background in astronomy as well. And then I saw her and I was like, whoa, well, she's a woman, she did fine, right? And I remember also growing up seeing people like Mae Jemison, for example, who was a woman of color and was the first African-American astronaut. And so for me, those role models being younger are the ones that gave me hope, right? And to be honest, these women in this case are the ones that paved the way for me, that paved, that started to change that culture. So I think in a more practical way, if you find yourself being in a minority in a field, seek out those role models. They're the ones that that allow you to dream a little bit, that allow you to have, that show you that you can make it.
Awesome. So there's a question from the audience about life on Mars, and is there a chance of life on Mars?
I mean, if we've gone to look for it, I think. So to be clear, Perseverance is looking for signs of ancient life on Mars. We do not think, we've been wrong before. We don't think that there's life on Mars right now, just because the things that we understand are needed for life are not present on Mars right now. As I mentioned, we're looking for signs of ancient life. So there's a possibility that there could have been life in the past. And I think we have to believe that that's a possibility if we're spending the time and energy to go look for it, right? So, and Mars might not be the only place where there could have been life. We're also looking for life in other places within the solar system. For example, we are building a mission to go to Europa, which is it's a moon of Jupiter that has an ocean and an ice shell on the core. And so it has water, it has energy, it has the building blocks for life as we know it. So we're also going there to look for, whether there could have been life out there. So I think it's possible that we might be able to find life or evidence of ancient life somewhere else.
Awesome. It's exciting. The Aga Khan often talks about the purpose of education. And to paraphrase, he highlights two things. One is to discover Allah's creation. And the second is to improve global quality of life. And it's specifically serving others to improve global quality of life. Earlier, we talked about discovering Allah's creation. And I'm wondering how you see your role in terms of that service to humanity and improving global quality of life.
Yeah, so that's definitely a tricky question that I struggled with when I was choosing this career path, right? And so there are definitely fields that you're like, oh, I definitely know how I'm contributing to serving my community. I definitely know how I'm doing that. You know, for example, if you're a doctor, you're doing that every day, right? Helping patients. It's a little bit different when it comes to aerospace, so much so that when I was in college, I was hesitating as to whether that was even the right field. I ended up spending a summer in India working in microfinance, thinking maybe I can use my skills more directly towards helping humanity. Discovered that that really wasn't the field for me and that really aerospace was it. But to me, there's three big ways off the top of my head that I think, you know, that we help humanity. The first is actually JPL and NASA as a whole doesn't just explore, well, we explore planets, but one of those planets is our own Earth. So all of the work that's being done in terms of carbon dioxide mapping, water, understanding where the water is, where the, you know, where what the climate is and how climate changes on our planet is being done here at JPL. And as you might know, right, climate change is probably the biggest existential threat that we have to our civilization. So we contribute in that way to helping in humanity's quality of life, right? Because we try to understand, okay, where are the waterbeds? Where should we plant? Where should we build? How do we, when there's disasters that happen, we use our satellites to observe those disasters, right? Whether there's a tsunami or an earthquake, to understand what happened, but also observe those areas, map them, and help relief efforts, right? All of those things happen with those Earth observing satellites. So that is one that directly impacts the community. The other is that, you know, there is a value, an inherent value in investing in science. And sometimes one of the challenges of investing in fundamental science is that you don't necessarily know how it's going to help you until it does and it changes, you know, your way of life, right? One anecdote, we had a mission that went to Jupiter decades ago and that big antenna failed. And they had to figure out how to send all of these images that we're taking through a much smaller link. And so they had to start what has since become image compression. And so when you have your GIFs or your PNGs, right, like all of those compressed images, that is because of that innovation that we had to do that then got passed along. Those cell phone cameras that you have, same, we had to miniaturize things. And now those cell phone cameras are used in remote areas to help with like diagnostic medicine, for example, right? So the impacts of innovation and technology are so far beyond, you know, what you're doing in a particular mission because you're improving the state of that technology. And then the third area that I think is a huge contribution is that we're also inspiring the public and that you can't really put a price on it or really understand what that means. But say if someone saw, you know, this Mars landing or whatever it is that we're doing and got interested in technology or STEM or thought, oh, I might belong here because look at these cool people doing this. And you know, that might not be the field that they choose. They might end up somewhere else, but we're providing sort of like this source of energy and interest in science that is important to our society. I think in order for society to keep growing and improving, you have to have these kind of extraordinary things to look up to be challenged by, to be interested in, and to take that into your daily life, whether that's a path you follow or not. So there's certainly ways, you know, they're not direct, but there are many ways in which we help society improve and you know, the overall welfare.
Awesome. No, I mean, some of them are so massive that I don't think we even realize the impact on our lives and even the lives of people in developing countries. You know, one thing that struck me is you said that with discovery, sometimes we don't know how it's going to impact quality of life. And with many of the people who have received Nobel laureates, they say exactly that they ended up getting the Nobel Prize because they solved a major problem that faces humanity. But when they began, they were just following their curiosity, and their curiosity about something new led them to make major improvements in quality of life.
Yeah, and sometimes it's just sort of a leap you have to take, and it's the difficulty of that kind of pure science, right? And something that we have to learn to communicate better, right? Why should we invest in this? Why should you give money here when there's other problems here? And it's like, well, because you don't know that a little bit of money here might help over here, but I can't pitch it to you as a business idea because that's not how it works, right? And that's why a lot of things are done, you know, via government, because that's how these things work, right? And then feed into public, you know, private industry, for example.
Exactly. Yeah. And the track record for curiosity-driven research is great. It's a gamble each time. All right. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time so far.
Oh, yeah. Time is fast.
I want to thank you so much for sharing your fields of the future, your journey, your path, your passions with us today. We genuinely enjoyed hearing about how widespread this field is and the opportunities available. And with that, thank you so much to you. Thank you to the audience for staying with us till the end and for your participation during the whole series of Fields of the Future sessions. There's a survey link in the chat, and we request that everyone please fill that out. It helps us improve. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.